Hello everybody, welcome back to the channel. Thank you very much for joining me on this Sunday afternoon, a rare Sunday live stream. Glad to be here. And Harlan saying hello from Sugar Grove, PA. I know exactly where you are. I think, if I remember correctly, you are up right near the New York border up there, kind of going into the Bus-Stuy area, right? That is a beautiful area, also Amish country, so I'm sure that you probably have friends and neighbors who belong to that community. Thank you for being here. Thank you all. So glad you're here. Hey, so yesterday we did a stream where I went over an article that was written in the Erie Times News by Tim Hath that was excellent reporting. The Erie Times News had worked to unseal the search warrants and returns that were done in Erie County. That would have been the search warrant of Sean Cranston's home and, you know, the Jeep and so forth. So we read that article. We're talking about the case of Rebecca Byler, who was the 23-year-old Amish mom, pregnant, who was discovered murdered in her Sparta Township home in Crawford County. This is in northwestern PA. And there was a suspect that has been arrested, a man named Sean Cranston. And anyway, so we're talking about this case and Mr. Cranston. This is Mr. Cranston right here. Okay, now I told you I would come back and we would talk more if I got the actual documents themselves. We could go over the documents. The AOPC liaison, who is amazing, worked on the weekend and she got these for me, or I should say for us. She delivered them out to all media that kind of are on her list for this case. I have added those to my Rebecca Byler case. If you go to gavinfish.com and go to Rebecca Byler's case page, you will see that I've added a whole bunch more documents. That includes the search warrant for 428 East Main Street in Quarry, PA, the search warrant for Sean Cranston's person, and then two search warrants for his Jeep Patriot, along with the returns. There are three returns, one for the house, one for his person, one for the Jeep Patriot. So I have those and we're going to go over those. These are on the website. They're available for my patrons to check out. But if you're not a patron of mine, don't worry about it. We're going to go through it on this video. Okay. We learned several new things and we learned them directly from the horse's mouth, which is very, very good. I think maybe where I want to start is maybe just to understand where we're talking about here. Okay. So the Byler farm, come on over here. This is the Byler's farm. It's on the corner of Fish Flats Road and Sportsman Road in Sparta Township outside of Spartansburg. Yeah. Spartansburg, PA. This whole area right here is a shooting club. It's like these are pistol ranges and there's some rifle ranges in here. And I mean, other than that, these are mostly Amish farms in here. Sparta Township has a really big Amish community. And so the farm that is on the corner here, really, there aren't very many cameras in the area, or you wouldn't think there are that many cameras in the area, but the Sportsman Club is actually one where there is some video footage that they showed at the preliminary hearing. Again, if you go over to the website, gavinfish.com, click on cases, then Rebecca Byler, I did a video on the preliminary hearing, so you can click on it right here, or just, it's on my YouTube channel, you guys can check it out, okay? So, and if I zoom out just to kind of show you where we are in the world here, we're in the northwestern section, almost the most northwestern section of Pennsylvania, right up in here. This is definitely Amish country. Okay. Let's see. Now, in terms of the Byler's farm compared to where the Cranstons live, the Cranstons live right on Main Street up here in Cory, Pennsylvania. It's a little less than a 20-minute drive from the Byler's farm down here. And Sean Cranston, we understand, was driving or was working as an Amish hauler at the time. He had given rides to several Amish families, which we actually find in the search warrants when we get into them. Okay. Now, this is, I showed you pictures of the Byler's farm. This is the Cranston's home that you can see on Google Maps. And we're going to come back to this so you guys can kind of see the area. We're going to come back to this. I'm going to come down the street here a little bit just so you can see. Right there is basically Sean Cranston's camper that we're going to get into. And if we even come further down the street, you can kind of see in there from this picture, you can see the black tailgate of what looks like a pickup truck and a red Jeep Patriot. And it does look like it's got a pretty, what do we call that? A sticker on the back window that you can see. This is going to be important, and we're going to come back to this. Okay. All right. Let's come over to here. Okay, so these are the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 documents that were unsealed by the court, thanks to the Erie Times News. Erie Times News, I think is how it is. And we're going to go through those, and then I've got an eighth document that I want to briefly go over. The first four tabs are mostly the same, so we're not going to have to read all of them. What's most important to me is the probable cause affidavit. Let us go on down, 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 down. So the one that we're looking at right here is the search of that home at 428 East Street, this home right here. Okay. Let's check out. I'm going to read the PCA. Okay. First paragraph is just about the affiant. So I'm going to skip that. All right. On February 26th, 2024, we just understand that the affiant is a Pennsylvania state trooper. Okay. And that he has all the credentials and so forth to investigate crime. Okay. On February 26th, 2024, at 12:26 p.m., Pennsylvania State Police at the Cory Barracks received a report of a deceased female located at 21845 Fish Flats Road in Sparta Township, Crawford County, PA. The complainant, a woman named Julie Warner, who we have discussed before because she was a witness at the preliminary hearing, had reported she and Andy Byler discovered his wife, Rebecca Byler, as deceased. Subsequently, state police units were dispatched to the residence. Upon troopers' arrival, Rebecca Byler was discovered laying on her back in the living room of the residence. A collection of blood was around Rebecca Byler, and she displayed multiple sharp force wounds to the neck. Additionally, there was an apparent injury to the head of Rebecca Byler. That head injury was later determined to be a gunshot wound at the autopsy. Now, in previous PCAs, which were brief, it described her head wound as a scalping wound, and we kind of wondered what that was. A very astute commenter on my video said maybe that is the gunshot wound, that scalping wound. And I think that we know that she died from sharp force trauma to the neck and a gunshot wound to the head. I think that the scalping wound is probably the gunshot wound to the head. There probably isn't another wound up there, though I don't know for sure. We probably may not know that until and if this comes to trial. But I thought I'd point that out. Okay. Once the scene was cleared and secured, it was discovered that the children of Andy and Rebecca Beiler, a 2-year-old female and a 3-year-old male, were present at the time of the incident. A preliminary interview with a 3-year-old male yielded the following information. A green truck pulled into their driveway and a man wearing sneakers entered the home and killed his mother. I was talking to another person about this, about the case. I believe that the 3-year-old boy is either close to 4 or has already turned 4 at this point. He's kind of on the upper end of 3 years old. He was able to communicate. And this is just me kind of speculating here. So, you know, don't take this as fact. This is only my opinion. But living in an Amish family, being Amish, he probably would be around, this is weird to say, but he would probably be around animal death pretty like any farm kid would be, right? He would understand by that age what alive is and what dead is, just because of the fact that he is growing up on a farm. I think his dad probably was a hunter, and they were farmers. I think that he probably knew that. So when he told police, yeah, a man in a green truck wearing sneakers came into the house and killed his mother, he understood what that meant. That's just my belief. As the Pennsylvania State Police Troop E Major Case Unit began conducting this death investigation, a search warrant was issued and served on the aforementioned residence. A search of the residence yielded shoe impressions resembling a Nike Air Force One within the residence. It should be noted that Andy and Rebecca Beiler are members of the Amish community. Their residence sits within an area heavily concentrated of people within the Amish community. That being said, it is uncommon for members of the Amish community to wear Nike Air Force One sneakers. No Nike Air Force One shoes were located within the residence. That is something that they asked Andy Beiler specifically when he testified at the preliminary hearing. Do you wear sneakers? Does anybody in your family wear sneakers? Is there any reason that there would be sneakers in your home? His answer to all that was no, we don't wear sneakers. There wouldn't be sneakers in our home. Okay. On December 26, 2024, at approximately 19:31 hours, so 7:31 at night, an interview with Julie Warner was conducted by Trooper Hubbard and Trooper Andrews of the PA State Police. Julie Warner also testified at the preliminary hearing. Julie Warner is a driver for the family because English drivers are required within the Amish community, as the Amish do not drive. For those who... I'm sorry to repeat myself, especially for those who understand the community. And I have to say, I don't really live in Amish country. I live adjacent to Amish country. I've had Amish workers work on our house, for example, and they've all been awesome. They refer to us as English. So when they say English, that means non-Amish. And in fact, in my preliminary hearing video that I did, I talked about the accents that they have, that they had in the preliminary hearing. Like Andy Beiler had a very thick Amish accent. And what I've learned since is that English really is the second language that they are taught. They don't learn English until later. So they refer to the language that they speak as Pennsylvania Dutch. It's really I think it's a Germanic pidgin at this point. I'm not really a language expert, but I think that's what it is. That's what it'd be considered now. Okay, the interview yielded the following timeline. Julie Warner related on February 26th, 2024, at approximately 8:15 a.m., she picked up Andy Beiler from his residence. They then proceeded to a nearby residence to pick up Dan Byler. Julie Warner then drove Andy Byler and Dan Byler to multiple job sites to conduct measurements for construction employment. The job sites ranged from Crawford County to Venango County. And if we go back to our map, let me just, I'm trying to remember what they testified to in, I think they said Sagertown. So they went to Sagertown right here. So almost due west from where they lived out in Sparta Township. And then Andy Byler said they were in the Utica area, but Julie Warner said that they were in the Polk area. Either way, in general, that is about the same area. Here is Utica right here, and here is Polk right here. So they actually traveled quite a fair distance, going all the way down to Sagertown, all the way out to Sagertown, then down to somewhere in the Utica Polk area before they went back up to Sparta Township, which was around noontime. Okay. Here we go. After conducting the work, Julie Warner took Andy Byler and Dan Byler home. Where am I? I'm trying to find my mouse. Sorry about that. On 226, February 26th, 2024, at approximately 12:15, Dan Byler was dropped off at his residence. And when I looked at the GIS information, let me zoom up in here real quick. He testified to it at the, Dan Byler testified at the preliminary hearing that he walked up to Andy and Rebecca's place. They weren't quite ready to go, so he walked down to the creek, and I would imagine it's this east branch of Oil Creek. He said that they had planted fish there, so he kind of wanted to check it out. And then when he saw Julie Warner arrive at Andy and Rebecca's, he walked back up. Then Julie Warner testified that they went back to Dan Byler's house and got a ladder, and then they went on their way. So it's slightly different from what is in the affidavit of probable cause. And the affidavit of probable cause is something, it's written under oath, right? But remember that this was a fluid investigation, and they were writing these things down as they were going along. And it really is just a narrative of kind of the events that they learned about. It is not evidence itself. It is testimony, basically, of the trooper. So it is slightly different than what the testimony was, which is not uncommon. I mean, witnesses are not really all that reliable. They will say and see different things, but it doesn't matter. Okay. So 12:15, Dan was dropped off at the residence. A few minutes later, Julie Warner and Andy Byler arrived at his residence. And upon arrival, this is when Andy Byler and Julie Warner discovered Rebecca Byler deceased. Subsequently, Julie Warner contacted 911. I've learned since, I wasn't showing you guys the screen. Sorry about that. I've learned since that, and Julie Warner testified to this, though I didn't really follow it until I've made some contacts on this one. So I think I've got a better understanding. Andy went inside. Julie did not leave because he was going in to get some tax documents so that she could drive him to where he was going to get his taxes prepared. So she was waiting outside, apparently, and he went inside, discovered what had happened, came outside, and told Julie. And you can check my other video about the preliminary hearing to get more details on that. Okay. So then the next thing they put in the PCA is on the 26th, same day, at approximately 8:18 p.m., an interview with Andy Byler was conducted by Trooper Hubbard and Trooper Andrews of the Pennsylvania State Police. Andy Beiler related. Approximately 2 weeks prior to this incident, Andy and Rebecca Beiler experienced a suspicious person around their residence. It would have been dark out at approximately 9:30 to 10 p.m. Allegedly, a white, bald male with a white beard came up to his residence. When confronted, the male inquired about purchasing the house. Andy Beiler believed the vehicle might be red in color, but he was unsure because it was dark out. Andy Beiler was unable to positively identify a name for the suspicious male. He testified in court that he was not 100% certain that that man who showed up approximately 2 weeks before his wife was murdered, he was not 100% certain whether or not it was the defendant, Mr. Cranston. And Ms. DiGiacomo, who is the, her name is Paula DiGiacomo. She's the Crawford County District Attorney. She kind of pressed him on that. And he said multiple times, I'm not 100%, not 100%. Okay. The following day, February 27th at approximately 11 a.m., video footage was retrieved from Sparta Sportsman Gun Club by Trooper Pietrone and Trooper Conroe, which shows the following. This is important, okay? On the 26th at 9:10 a.m., it shows a red Jeep Patriot traveling south on Sportsman Road, Sparta Township, Crawford County, which is in close proximity to the crime scene. Let's go back over to the map, okay? So he was, well, a red Jeep Patriot was traveling south past Sportsman, past the Sportsman Club on Sportsman Road toward Fish Flats Road. That is a video that they showed during the preliminary hearing. It is indeed a red Jeep Patriot. I witnessed that video. Okay. On 12/27/2024 at 18:04 hours, so 6:04 p.m., Trooper Nicholas Kaschalk and Trooper Michael Bruneau, and Bruneau actually testified at the preliminary hearing, interviewed Katie Beiler of 18440 Rigby Road. Clara Wengard of 18440 Rigby Road, this is Sparksenburg, and Chester Wengard of the same address. So Katie Beiler, Clara Wengard, Chester Wengard, who lived at 18440 Rigby Road. I should have gotten that ready for you. Give me just 1 second here, guys. Let me get directions from Fish Flats. So 18440 Rigby Road in Spartansburg. Rigby Road, sorry. Rigby Road. An address is coming to Titusville. But that shouldn't be, it should be Spartansburg. Give me just a second. Oh, it's Rigby at, no, that's South Carolina. So Rigby is coming back to Titusville. I would imagine that that is the same place. So let me just show you this. So Rigby Road is here in Titusville, which is about 10 minutes, 15 minutes away from Spartansburg, Sparta Township. When I drive out to Spartansburg, I go through Titusville. So they're 10 or 15 minutes away from the Beilers. They're not in by car, not by horse and buggy. They're not in the direct area. Okay. Katie Beiler's recently separated husband, William Beiler, was utilizing an individual named John for rides. One day when requesting a ride, again, this activity is referred to as hauling in our area, Amish hauling. So John was unable to accommodate, but suggested to William Beiler that his father, Sean, would be able to give him a ride. William Beiler accepted the ride from Sean and immediately got an uneasy feeling about him. From December 10th to February 16th, Katie Beiler, Clara Wingard, and Chester Wingard have had very odd experiences with this individual they know as Sean. They do not know the last names of Sean or John. After Sean provided William Beiler with a ride, Sean would randomly show up at their residence on Rigby Road. And, I mean, if we go back, let's just zoom out. So, I want to find where Corey is. So, Corey's way up here at the top, right? This is where he lives in Corey. And then Titusville is way down here. So, it's pretty fair distance from Corey. Okay. So, he would just randomly show up at their Rigby Road. And I really hope that Spartansburg 16434. I really hope that is. Let's just see. Let me just see if I can. Give me just a second, guys, because Rigby Road in Titusville just doesn't seem right. Yeah, the closest one that Google is finding is Titusville. So, I think that's probably it. Okay. So Cranston, well, a man named Sean is randomly showing up at the residence. Okay. On one occasion, Sean drove a Jeep to their residence and parked in their driveway. Katie Beiler described the Jeep as red in color, a square body with a white sticker on the back window. I think this is one where in the preliminary hearing, if I am remembering correctly, this is something where the testimony that I heard and what I'm reading in the PCA does diverge slightly, because I think Ms. DiGiacomo, no, it wasn't Ms. DiGiacomo. It was Sean Cranston's attorney asked about specific markings on the Jeep, stickers, dents, scratches, things like that. And the testimony that I don't think they mentioned a sticker in the window, but that's from memory, right? I don't have a recording of it. They didn't allow any recording or transcribing of it. So that's just from my memory. I might be wrong there. Okay. Going back over here. They advised Sean was clad in black clothing from head to toe, including a black beanie cap and black sunglasses. He had a small black pistol in a holster on his belt. She said in her testimony that she assumed it was in a holster. What she knows is that it was on his side. So there's a slight difference there too. Again, coming from memory, that has been over a week, but my memory, I feel pretty confident in my memory. They described him as acting unusual. He was walking around their property, looking aimlessly into their fields, and his speech made no sense. He was inquiring as to when and where they attend church and that he wished to go with them. The family described Sean as tall, heavyset, with gray-colored facial hair. They estimate he is around 50 years old. This made me wonder if Sean, at this time, if like he wasn't making any sense, does that mean he wasn't making sense to them because they are culturally different? Or was he inebriated? Was he drunk? Was he high on something? I don't know, right? But I mean, I don't think it's the first thing. I don't think that they couldn't understand, or that his speech made no sense because they couldn't understand the language very well. They all speak English just fine, right? I'm wondering if he was high on something or if he was inebriated or something. I don't know. He was inquiring as to when and where they attend church and that he wished to go. The family, okay, we already did that, which I thought was kind of strange as far as, hey, I want to go to church with you. Okay. They were able to obtain a phone number for Sean through open source queries. A Sean Cranston was discovered to reside at 428 East Main Street in the city of Corey, Erie County. Sorry, guys, my throat is very dry. I should have a cough drop or something. Okay. So let's see. Trooper Nicholas Kaschalk and Trooper Michael Bruneau drove past this address and observed a red Jeep Patriot in the driveway. On February 28th at 1:18 p.m., same troopers interviewed Alexander Capilanti. I definitely spelled that wrong in my notes. If you go back, if you go to the website, if you go to my website on this page, you will see that I've got my notes here. I had wondered if I spelled that right. I definitely did not. Let's see. And Jonathan Santry. At Santry's residence, in reference to his neighbor Sean Cranston, the following information was provided by Capilanti and Santry. They both acknowledged they knew the neighbor that resided behind the residence, adding his name was Sean Cranston. Real quick, part of the testimony that Santry gave at the hearing was that, let me go up here a little bit, was that he lived behind the Cranstons, like he lived back here behind the Cranstons, but that this property right here, in between the Cranston residence and the Dollar General store, is his property as well. So I would imagine that these boats, the tractor, these are just items that are for sale that that are on the property when Google went by and took that picture, but that is property that belongs to Mr. Santry, according to my memory of his testimony. Okay. They acknowledged they knew the neighbor behind them, adding his name is Sean Cranston, adding his nickname is Rumble. They advised that Sean Cranston is a member of the War Dogs Motorcycle Club, adding he is a sergeant in arms. Capilanti believes that Sean Cranston is with the Erie chapter of the War Dogs and explained that they are a 1% support group to the Hells Angels. I had no idea what that meant. Call me naive. I didn't know what a 1% support group was. I looked it up. I may even still have it up. Yeah. Looked it up on Wikipedia. And the 1% thing has to do with a quote that was attributed to a guy in the like years and years ago saying that 99% of bikers are law-abiding citizens. There we go. Yeah, so a comment made by William Barry in 1960, former president of the American Motorcyclist Association, saying that 99% of cyclists are law-abiding citizens, implying that the 1% were outlaws. So a 1% motorcycle club is an outlaw motorcycle club, according, again, this is according to Capilanti in this case, right? I have no idea if that is true or not. However, I do know there's something that I found. I'm gonna bring it up here real quick. This is the War Dogs Motorcycle Club website. From what I can tell, this is definitely their website. I'm gonna zoom up on this. This sentence or this paragraph here really struck me, okay? The War Dogs Motorcycle Club respects all clubs, citizens, and law enforcement agencies that respect us. What that implies to me is that if you do not show respect to us, we will not respect you. And who is the arbiter of whether somebody is respecting them or not? Well, they are, right? So this kind of to me is an in between the lines of, hey, don't mess with us. We just want to do our thing, right? I don't know if they are actually an outlaw club that they are doing that, you know, they're affiliated with the Hells Angels, that they're doing, I don't know, drug dealing and stuff like that, like the Hells Angels have historically done. I have no idea. I just feel like reading that sentence, yeah, this is a group of guys that are willing to do things, I guess. I don't know how else to say that. It did put a chill down my spine a little bit when I read that. It does talk about how they started as veterans of the United States military, and Mr. Cranston is a veteran of the Navy, I understand. Okay, so whether he is, that actually reminds me of, there's this picture that I have of Mr. Cranston. It's kind of, it's not the best picture ever, but you can see he's got an MC patch right here. He's probably got a three-part patch over here that would be the War Dogs patch. And if he may have, I don't know that he does, but he may have a 1% patch on the other side. There are people that are saying that he did. I can't see it. The other thing about this is this thing right here, right? That he has a sharp instrument on his belt in this photo. It makes me wonder if he frequently had a sharp instrument with him. Okay, let's go back over here. Okay. Santry was told a red-colored SUV had been observed parked at Sean Cranston's residence, and he explained that Sean Cranston's wife drives that vehicle. Santry was asked if he ever observed Sean Cranston driving the vehicle, and he advised that Cranston drives that vehicle all the time now since his truck had disappeared. Cranston used to have a black Chevrolet 1500, but Capilanti nor Santry have seen the vehicle since the fall of 2023. And let me just come back over to this photo or this Google Maps here. Let me come down the street just a little bit. And I'm just going to look right back in there. In this view, there is a black pickup truck right there. And then I think we're seeing the Jeep Patriot right there. It's kind of funny how Google Images works, because if we go just a little bit further down and look back there, then it's slightly different. No, I think actually, you know, there's the Jeep and I think the truck is behind there. It's hard to tell. We're going to come back to this, by the way. Okay. Santry described the red SUV to be a Jeep Patriot. He was asked if he noticed the red SUV to be gone on Monday or anything irregular about the SUV. Santry explained he was home off and on Monday. By the way, Santry did testify at the preliminary hearing. I asked Santry if he noticed the red SUV to be gone during the morning of Monday 2/26. Santry explained he did notice the vehicle was not present, and he thought that was odd because Cranston's wife works third shift and usually has the vehicle. So the vehicle is usually home after the third shift. Santry, third shift meaning night shift. Santry added the SUV was gone most of the day on Monday. Santry was asked if he knew where Sean Cranston's wife worked, and he did not, nor did he know her name. By the way, I think I just completely skipped over that they are described as always wearing black, and I don't know. I mean, these are pretty colorful clothes, but yeah, they've definitely got their black leathers. Okay. Santry also added that he has seen Sean Cranston carrying a pistol. He explained that every time he has seen Sean Cranston, he would be carrying a pistol. This is not completely uncommon for our neck of the woods. Open carry is a legal thing, and so you will, with some frequency, see somebody with a gun on their belt, especially when you get out into the even more rural areas than where I live. It becomes more and more common. If you guys have been on my channel for any length of time, you've actually seen videos of me just out in my sister and brother-in-law's backyard firing off guns, you know, into the mountain. It's gunshots and stuff like that. It's just very commonplace. So nobody would bat an eye at that. So he described the pistol as being smaller in size and black in color. After speaking with Santry, the troopers encountered the red 2012 Jeep Patriot bearing this license plate traveling west on East Main Street as it passed their stationary unmarked police sedan while they were located at King Street. The operator was observed to be a white non-Hispanic male, wearing a red beanie, smoking a cigarette with facial hair. On 2/28 at 1500 hours, Trooper Nicholas Kaschuk and Trooper Michael Bruneau observed cameras positioned on a building, namely Elmwood National Forge, which was located directly across from the Cranstons' residence. Let's again go back over to this area. This is this facility directly across the street. Now, I looked around. I only saw like one camera. I think it was over here. Like there's a camera there. But again, this is all really low resolution, right? So it's hard to tell if some of the, like that might be a camera right there. There might be, like I can't quite tell. But what I do know is that from about the position that we're in right now, this is the position, maybe a little bit, maybe just a little bit, you know, closer to the house. I can't get that much closer on Google Maps, but there, the camera is facing about where we're looking now. It's a little bit different in that the, in the camera footage that we saw at the preliminary hearing, these boats are not there. There is a tractor there, but it was a yellow tractor. It looked like a Case tractor as opposed to this one, which to me, I'm no expert, but this probably looks like a Farmall or a Massey Ferguson or something like that. But anyway, you could see in the video the Patriot parked basically where it is right now in this Google Maps view, and you could see this camper back here that is blocked from view where we are right now. But this is basically the view that we saw in that preliminary hearing. So the cameras must be in this area somewhere. I just can't spot them myself, but I'm going to come back up the road just a little bit so that we'll be able to see. Actually, you know what? The view was a little bit more like this. But again, the tractor was a yellow tractor, a little boat, a lawn tractor wasn't there. I don't remember a big boat being there. This is more the view. You can see his motorcycle in this photo. And in the preliminary hearing, obviously the truck wasn't there, and the Patriot was a little bit parked further back. So you could see the whole hatchback, basically, is what I'm saying. I'm trying to communicate here. I don't know that I'm doing a good job. But that is what I saw in the video at the preliminary hearing. Okay. So contact was made with Justin Amy. Amy was asked if the cameras positioned on his building were operational and if they would capture the neighbor's residence, to which he advised they did. Video was requested from them for Monday 2/26 from 0600 to 1730, so 5:30 in the afternoon. In the early morning of February 29th, a trash pull was conducted at 428 East Main, which is the house that we're, it's Cranston's house. Upon analyzing the contents of the trash, a glove was recovered. The significance of the glove is that the glove resembles an item recovered from the scene of the crime, which was a small piece from a perceived rubber glove. That small piece was perceived to be consistent and similar constructed material, color, and grip ridge pattern to the glove found with the trash pull. Also in the trash was a mail title to Sean Cranston at 428 East Main. They did talk about this in their testimony, the trooper did, in his testimony about the glove. Let me just describe what he said. This is from memory. I really need to go back to my notes. But this is stuck with me because the black nitrile glove they described as having what they were calling a fish scale pattern. And when he described what the pattern was, it was a triangle, but the bottom section of the triangle was curved down. And he said that in our area, that pattern is actually only sold by one particular manufacturer. And as I looked for that pattern, doing again just kind of a layman search of like Amazon and Google Shopping and stuff like that, I couldn't find that pattern anywhere. I could find other patterns, diamond patterns and things like that, but they were connecting the glove that they found in his trash to the the fragment of the glove at the Byler's residence, not only in that they were both black, they were both nitrile, but they both had that fish scale pattern they described as fish scale. Okay. On the 1st of March, troopers interviewed Andy Byler and showed him an image of the small piece of rubber, of dark rubber glove material, which was located at the crime scene. Andy Byler related that he does not recognize the small piece of dark rubber glove material, nor does he have anything that resembles that type of material at his residence. Okay, on 2/29, going back in time at approximately 10:30 a.m., an interview with Rebecca Byler, different Rebecca Byler, spelled differently and was a neighbor, was conducted by Trooper Hahn and Trooper Giebel, I guess, or Geibel, of the Pennsylvania State Police. Rebecca Byler related that on the 16th of February at approximately 10:30 a.m., a red SUV pulled into her driveway located at 21941 Fish Flats Road, Sparta Township. She observed a white bald male with white or salt and pepper hair in the sides of his head driving the vehicle. No other occupants were observed inside the vehicle. Rebecca Byler indicated the red SUV had roof racks on top of the vehicle and a sticker or decal on the back passenger side of the rear hatch door. And we do see that sticker, right? I don't know if I can get any. I don't think I can get any closer, but you can see that little sticker. But In my memory, she didn't remember the sticker at the preliminary hearing. This red SUV then backed out of her driveway and traveled toward the victim's residence slash crime scene. Rebecca Byler did not see this red SUV travel back past her residence after it initially left. Okay, same day, 1:58 p.m., an interview with Clara Wingard was conducted by Trooper Hubbard. Clara was presented with a picture of the vehicle, of a vehicle, a red 2012 Jeep Patriot, LJB, so it is the vehicle, the Cranston's vehicle, belonging to Sean Cranston. Claire Wenger did remember seeing the vehicle. She indicated that on the 16th, she saw the vehicle drive by her residence. When looking at the picture, she specifically remembered seeing the sticker on the passenger side rear window. When asked if she knew who the driver was, Claire Wingard indicated she believed the driver's first name was Sean. Like she knew who that was. And this is slightly different from testimony, at least to my memory. But anyway. So at 4:07 p.m. the same day, members of the State Police Vice Unit were attempting surveillance on a red 2012 Jeep Patriot belonging to Cranston. Information obtained led the Vice Unit to the vehicle parked at a public space. Vice Unit members were able to take a picture of the tire tread. He did testify in the preliminary hearing that he got the front and rear tire. He got pictures of one side. I think he said it was the driver's side, if my memory serves. Either way, it was one side, front and rear. The tire tread is of significance because tire tread marks were collected, processed from the crime scene. The tire tread appeared to resemble the tire tread impressions found in the mud of the driveway at the crime scene. She testified that one side was bald. Okay, March 1, 12:15. Trooper Hahn, Trooper Nicholas Kaschok followed up with the Elwood National Forge regarding requested video surveillance. While there, troopers spoke with Mr. Amy, who allowed troopers to review some of the footage from the day of the incident, 2/26. It should be noted that the surveillance camera at Elwood National Forge run off of motion detection. So yeah, it does. I saw this video in the preliminary hearing. It is quite skippy. In fact, it was the most painful thing ever to watch. I've shared this with you guys already. It was like a half a dozen of copies of my grandma trying to run the computer. It was embarrassingly slow, but they did show that, and we did see the things that are described here. The video shows the following. The red Jeep Patriot left the property located, you know, we know where it is, on 226 between 839 and 842. And the reason that they have that gap is because it is a motion detecting camera, right? So at 839, the car was there. At 842, the car was not there. And that's how they know is between, it was in those 4 minutes. The red Jeep Patriot returns to the property between 1355 and 1402 for the same out, for the same reason they have that, that gap, right? That, I guess, range because of the nature of those cameras. Okay. From 1402, so 202 in the afternoon to 1715, so 515 in the afternoon, we're talking 3 hours and 13 minutes. A white male with a heavier set build that appears to be bald is seen opening the doors of the vehicle to include the rear, to include the rear hatch door. This male was observed to be in and out of the vehicle with items in his hands in the driveway. The video also depicts a large camper sitting behind the red Jeep Patriot. And let's go back over here. This is basically what we were looking at, right? So we can't really see behind the camper. We can't see the entrance to the camper. All we could see is basically where the black truck is now was the Jeep Patriot with the hatchback open and an individual that looked like Mr. Cranston going back and forth between the two areas. Let's see. It is apparent that while this man, carrying items to the side of the camper, out of the camera's view, it is apparent that this white male started a fire beside the camper because the camera depicted visible smoke rolling into the air. And that is true. I did see that. There was smoke coming up. I wanted to see if there is like a fire pit back there. Like it looked like that smoke was coming from right next to the camper. Like it was right back in this area. Doesn't look to me that there is a fire pit, but there is stuff to burn, I guess. And who knows when this, when Google Street View came by and took this. I have no idea. So let's get back to this view. The video looked pretty much about like that. Okay. In my training and experience as a Pennsylvania State Police trooper, it is known that individuals who commit crimes either conceal or destroy any evidence by means of fire or otherwise. In this officer's training and experience, it is common for knives, blades, cutting instruments, firearms, ammunition, shoes, clothing, DNA, fingernail clippings, electronic devices, and disposable gloves to be typically stored within the residence. He's making a case for why he wants the search warrant. It is known that a firearm and cutting instrument was used in the commission of this crime, and it is known that Sean Christopher Cranston frequently carries a pistol. Evidence collected from the scene of this crime include a piece of dark-colored disposable glove that is patterned. Found within the trash from the residence of 428 East Main Street was a disposable glove that is consistent with the partial piece of disposable glove found at the crime scene. Shoe impressions consistent with an athletic shoe were located inside the residence of the crime scene. Said shoe impressions were preserved and secured by the FSU. This was, they were actually there securing the crime scene and doing their investigations when I was out there that morning. Shoes are generally stored at a residence in which a person lives, and it is believed that the shoes Cranston wore during the incident would be stored if they still exist in the residence. Further, the gathering of shoes would show the size of shoe Cranston wears for future comparison to shoe prints. The items identified to be searched for and seized are believed to be stored within the residence belonging to Sean Christopher Cranston. Based on the totality of circumstances described here in this affidavit, this officer believes there is sufficient cause to further this investigation by collecting evidence from within the residence located at 428 East Main Street, Corey, PA. Also, due to the extensive media attention and this being a high-profile case, this affiant believes there is good cause for this search warrant to be sealed for the safety of the family, officers, and evidence. Due to the potential threat in executing the search warrant at the residence of Sean Christopher Cranston, his criminal history, and known to have weapons registered to him, the Pennsylvania State Police Special emergency response team has been requested to execute the warrant to avoid any harm to citizens of the Commonwealth and other members of the Pennsylvania State Police. For this reason, your affiant respectfully requesting the issuance of a nighttime search warrant. So they want surprise, I guess, right? Okay, so that is the search warrant. Now, if we go over to this one, which is the search of Cranston himself, it is all the same all the way down to this paragraph right here, okay? So it says, due to the fact that it is known touch DNA can be found inside gloves worn by an individual, and the aforementioned gloves recovered from the trash of Sean Christopher Cranston is similar to the piece of glove found in the residence of the homicide scene, this affiant is respectfully requesting this body warrant for Sean Christopher Cranston to further this investigation. Also, due to the extensive media attention, they're asking for it to be sealed. Okay? And then they ask for the issuance of the nighttime warrant and for the CERT team to respond. The third warrant is for the Jeep Patriot. Again, it is all the same until here. And then we read this. Based on your affiant's training and experience, it is known that digital or electronic data associated with said vehicle, the Jeep, within any infotainment system or any digital recording module thereof may store location information, vehicular movements, and vehicle dynamics. When speaking of vehicle dynamics, it is referring to acceleration and vehicle stoppage. So that's something that they did not talk about at the preliminary hearing, but there is in pretty much any car with an ECU at this point, data that is collected about acceleration and deceleration. And so by using that and using the timestamps, they can actually, and like cross-referencing that with the GPS data that they have and cross-referencing that with the cell phone tower ping data that they have, they will be able to, likely, they will be able to map out his very specific route to the crime scene and back if he indeed did what they allege that he is doing. This information can be relevant to further the investigation if GPS data is stored, which can provide the trip the aforementioned vehicle may have traveled. Well, that was kind of clunky. I'm sorry, I read that wrong. And then we learn later through the, we learned it at the preliminary hearing, there was actually a GPS device attached by the finance company to that Jeep. Okay. One more search warrant. Again, it is for the Jeep. And basically it is saying that on 3-2 at 1904, nighttime search warrants to seize and process the Jeep were requested and granted through the Court of Common Pleas. Although the vehicle was seized within the time restraint provided, due to the large-scale operation, the Pennsylvania State Police, FSU, was unable to process the vehicle within the time constraint. That being said, a new search warrant is being requested in order to process the vehicle. So in this case, we have four search warrants and we have three returns because the first Jeep search warrant, they couldn't return anything because they didn't get to it in time. They had to get a second warrant. Okay, let me take a break here real quick. Before we get to the returns, let us just check a couple of comments here real quick. Stacy Lynn Blue, does the 3 to 4 year old know colors? It's been quite a many years since mine was that age. I don't remember. I think so. I think they do. Yeah. Let's see. Golden Spudlet saying, seems like he was stalking them, sort of. Them not having phones would be scary for them. Yeah, and we still, I mean, it does seem like stalkish behavior, right? Looking at the map, seeing where he's going, and, you know, we don't know that it was him a couple weeks prior that was out there, but if it was him, it is pretty stalky activity. And, yeah, I agree with you. William Miller says Rigby Road would probably be a Titusville address. So I couldn't find a Spartanburg address, so they wrote that wrong. Let's see. Golden Spudlet says I took it to mean he was drunk, like he wasn't making sense when he was speaking. Golden Spudlet asks, isn't the sergeant at arms the enforcer of the group? I may be wrong, but I heard about that in another case. I actually don't know the answer to that question. It's a good question, Spudlet. All right, let's see. Harlan says, I work for that company in Irvine, PA. You're probably talking about the forge. Yeah. Keegan, you think a person who did it with no fingerprints or DNA is going to cut off part of the glove and put a piece in the Amish trash? I highly doubt that. I mean, I don't know. I don't know. Keegan said it was the passenger side that they looked at. Thank you for correcting me on that, Keegan. Chrissy asks, don't mean to be nosy, but do you live near Mercer County, Gavin? I just live in Western Pennsylvania is really all I'll say. So Mercer County, Butler County, Crawford, Clarion, Venango, did I say Butler? That area. I live in Western PA. Let's see. Circumstantial evidence, nice day out. A lot of people got their car washed that day, maybe burned trash, and that was Jeep. After all, kids saw green truck, not red. Okay, let's take this opportunity to talk about circumstantial evidence for a second, okay? And Keegan, I disagree with you that all of the evidence is circumstantial. There is actual evidence here that is not circumstantial evidence. The videos, they're not circumstantial. The video of what appears to be Cranston at his house, that's not circumstantial evidence. The video at the car wash, that's not circumstantial evidence. The GPS data is not circumstantial. The cell phone ping, that is not circumstantial. The video from the Sportsman Club, that is not circumstantial. What is circumstantial is witness testimony saying I saw a red Jeep, and the little boy saying it was a green truck, and the person saying she was sewing and saw the Jeep drive by. The person who was driving the Jeep or the horse and buggy and saw that the Jeep was parked in the driveway. That is all circumstantial. And let's talk about it real quick because this is really important. This is the way that I understand circumstantial evidence as it was described by a judge at a murder trial that I was covering. Okay. Actually, you know what? Now to think of it, by this definition, all the stuff that I just said was circumstantial is actually direct evidence. Seeing the Jeep drive by, that's direct evidence. Seeing the Jeep in the driveway, that is direct evidence. Saying that it was a green truck, that is direct evidence. So let me describe what is circumstantial, what is direct. Okay. Direct evidence is something that is actually seen by the per or heard by the person who saw or heard it, who can testify to it. So, for example, if I'm standing in the middle of a field, say there are woods on one end, woods on the other, and I'm standing in the middle of a field that is blanketed with a fresh layer of snow. It is pristine. There is nothing out there. I can just see fresh snow. And then I see a deer leave the woods on this side, run across the field, and go into the woods. I can provide direct evidence that a deer ran from there through this field to there. That is direct evidence. Okay. Now, say I leave the scene and another person comes a few minutes later and goes into the same field and walks up and they see in this pristine area deer tracks that are in the direction of that direction, and they come from that direction, and they can identify these tracks as deer tracks. They know the direction because of the shape of the tracks. They can say a deer went from those woods through this field into those woods. But the evidence that they're giving is circumstantial. That is the difference between direct evidence and circumstantial evidence. Okay, but here is the kicker. When we watch crime shows on TV, Law and Order and, you know, CSI and stuff like that, and they get into court and they say, oh, this is all just circumstantial. This is not a good case. Just circumstantial evidence, Your Honor. That does not happen in real life. Circumstantial evidence is most of the evidence that is ever brought up in a case. Most of it is circumstantial, and it carries the same weight as direct evidence. That's the thing that we all have been lied to by Hollywood about. Going back to the deer running through the field scenario, what is more powerful, the fact that I saw it or the fact that somebody can identify it? Well, it's probably direct evidence is probably more powerful, but it doesn't make the circumstantial evidence unreliable or discounted in any way. It would still be good evidence. Okay, so that's just something that's really important. I covered two murder trials last year where 90% of the state's case was circumstantial and they won. It happens all the time. But I mean, I appreciate the comment. I'm just saying the evidence is piling up against Mr. Cranston. Let's see. Yeah, and it's perfectly fine. Keegan apologized, and Golden Spudlet says, don't apologize, you're thinking out loud, and that's perfectly correct. Okay, let's see if there's anything else. All right. Andrew Brett, thanks, Gavin. Any murder weapons found? That is a good segue. Let's go ahead and go back over to the documents, okay? Okay, the next three documents are the return of the search warrants. There are three of them, one for the house and property, one for Mr. Cranston himself, one for the Jeep. I think we can go in reverse order real quick because it'll be quicker. Okay. This one is the Jeep. They took 14 cotton tipped applicators. Those likely would be swabs that they took looking for some kind of touch DNA. Okay. And that's all they got. This return is for Mr. Cranston himself. They did two DNA collectors. So they probably took buccal swabs or took his spit or something like that. So they collected his DNA and they collected his fingerprints and handprints. And it looks like they did it for both hands there. Okay. So that's what we got from the Jeep and from Mr. Cranston himself. When we get to the property, it's a little bigger, okay? So we don't really need to dive into each one of these, but we'll go through them all. Savage Model 111 30-06. That would likely be a rifle, I'm guessing. A Ruger American 30-06. Again, a rifle. Unknown make, bolt-action rifle. A Galil Ace SAP 5.56. That would be what some people might consider like a military style weapon. It's just a semi-automatic rifle that is kind of dressed up and outfitted to be kind of a military weapon. A Smith & Wesson Shield 9mm. A Smith & Wesson Shield is a small handgun. It's not tiny like a Derringer or something, but a Shield is a handgun that people might choose to conceal if they have a concealed carry permit or if they are criminal, right? A Savage Model 103 22 caliber, And then a 9mm Winchester silver tip box. And then we've got ammunition, loaded magazine, an ammunition bag. Excuse me. Cartridge casing. Man, sorry, guys. Been talking too much today. But basically, lots of ammunition, lots of casings, lots of undischarged casing, lots of discharged casings, lots of magazines with cartridges in them. So more magazines. We've got a holster. We've got two Bulldog holsters here, plastic dual magazine pouch, a black pistol bag, a sleeping bag, a pair of Nike Air Force Ones. And this was described at the preliminary hearing, excuse me, as having been found in the camper. Underneath the mattress, there was like a plywood door, and they were inside there. Clear pillow bag, partial, I think that's what that means. I looked it up to see if it was a brand. Let me go back over here. Sorry. I looked up to see if, sorry, this was a brand. I think that is a misspelling. It's a partial box of black nitrile gloves. Then a black nitrile glove, a bank bag, 5 bank bags. Who has 5 bank bags? That is a weird thing to have, right? I don't have a bank bag. I mean, unless you have a business that's cash and you're making cash deposits, I guess. Okay, a pick list, a pull list, black and red seat cover, a gun lock with keys, clothing fiber, 3 pairs of blue jeans, a black belt, a black smartphone, a Jeep key with a red keychain. Man, sorry, guys. And then 18 undischarged 40 caliber Smith & Wessons and Winchester ammunition box with 18 undischarged 30-06 cartridge casing. So your question about if there were any murder weapons found, I noticed that there's no knife on here. Not one that I saw anyway. I mean, I kind of went quickly, but I've gone through this a couple times. I don't see a knife. There was a broken knife found in the Byler's residence that could have been used. But they did find several guns, rifles and handguns. And when asked about that by the defense lawyer, I can't remember his name right now, Mr. Kern, I think. The trooper that was being asked about whether he had found the murder weapon simply testified, "We are still looking for the murder weapon." So my guess is that would mean that they're still processing everything that they collected from the search warrants. All right. Let's see what else you guys are saying here. Let's see. Astrid Galactic, great handle. From what I understand, his wife was a nurse. I'm assuming she may have brought some of those gloves home from work. If she did, she would have had to bring an entire box, right, or a partial box. But actually, Astrid, that is a very good segue for the last document that I want to show you guys. I actually found a document. I've been working toward trying to figure out the motive in this case. I know that there are rumors about a grandchild that was adopted out. I still haven't been able to corroborate that. I do have to say that I am kind of leaning that direction, that rumor that has just washed our entire area. I'm leaning toward that direction that it is plausible, but I don't have any either direct or circumstantial evidence about it. I only have rumor. I don't have anything else about it. But I'm still working on that. But there are other things that could be, indicative of a of a motive. We know, well, we don't know. We believe because of the probable cause affidavit and because of the picture of Mr. Cranston that I have right here, that he did belong to a motorcycle club, that he did belong to War Dogs there in Erie, and that they may be what is known as an outlaw motorcycle club. It could be, I've worked on several cases in the past where in Northern California, the Hells Angels were involved, and there were, in those cases, there were like massive amounts of drug dealing happening. So I do know that there are motorcycle clubs that do illegal things that are actually outlaw, not outlaw in the way Johnny Cash was outlaw, but in the way outlaws are actually outlaw, right? The other thing I found, though, is, and let's come over here, is I found this document. And it's pretty heavily redacted, but this basically is a complaint against Jamie Cranston and her duties as a nurse. I don't know who the complainant is here. The complainant is what would we call this? Is confidential, I guess. Okay, but there are a couple things in this complaint that was complained to the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania Department of State Bureau of Professional and Occupational Affairs. Man, say that 10 times fast. That is a state agency that I had no idea existed until I found this document. But let me just read a couple of things from here. It says, however, on the blank of blank at approximately blank, so I'm guessing that is a date and time, I witnessed Jamie Nurse handling all the narcotics drawer after the narcotic count had been completed with the off-going nurse. Within a short time, she told me that she was clumsy and had dropped the cards and accidentally put three holes in an Oxy 20 milligram card. She handed me a medication cup with three gray pills. I did not observe her punching them out of the narcotic card. I knew that they were a non-narcotic and a drug called perphenazine 4 milligrams. So if I understand this correctly, she says that Jamie Cranston accidentally put three holes in a card full of 20 milligram Oxy pills and then said she did it accidentally, showed her a cup with three gray pills in it, and then that person goes, that is not Oxy. That is perphenazine. So it's like, ooh, I took these three Oxys and then I tried to pass them off as this. This is just somebody's complaint, right? So I said to her that those are not Oxy 20s. She grabbed the cup. Really? Oops. She then reached behind the work laptop and, air quotes, well, printed quotes, found another medication cup with the correct narcotics in it, as well as an added dose of methadone. Scrolling down, it is also noted that her shifts just prior to the 11th there had been no less than 5 Oxy 20 milligram tablets wasted due to accidental holes in the medication card. Accidental holes. Jamie signs out more narcotics on patients in her care than what other nurses on the same assignments do. When I switched to the night shift is when I began to question if narcotics were being diverted by the said RN, meaning Mrs. Cranston. When I went to my director of nursing several times with the concerns, or I went to the DON several times, spoke with the DON about a resident, I would guess that means a patient, as she had been in Jamie Cranston's care for an extended amount of time. Blank received PRN narcotics very consistently only while in Jamie's care, was then transferred to another part of the facility. When she transferred, she rarely complained of pain that was in need of narcotics. So this person was complaining one time that Jamie Cranston tried to accidentally basically write off 3 Oxy tablets as, and I guess show them to their coworker as, oh, look, I accidentally did this. Those aren't oxy. Oh, they're not really. Oh, let me look around. Oops, these are them, right? It's something like that. And then they also allege that she was dosing a patient with narcotics at a much higher rate than other nurses that cared for that patient. And when that patient was transferred to another facility or another area, she didn't complain of pain that was in need of narcotics. I guess what I'm getting at here is that it's possible that the motive had something to do with narcotics. It had something to do with needing money. Maybe it was a robbery. I don't know. But, and then the rumor that there was a grandchild that was adopted by an Amish couple that lived in that house previous to the Bylers, that is out there. And it is widely circulated in the community. And it is, I guess it's possible. For me, I need to get that possible over the hump into plausible territory before I really kind of talk about the things that I've learned. I have lots of information that I've learned, but I don't know that it's necessarily reliable. All right. So that's all I have for you guys. Let me see if there are any comments on this sort of stuff. Chrissy says, so if she hid these pills and was trying to see if she could skate without being caught, I've seen this happen a lot by those you're assuming to be honest and professional. I don't know. Yeah, I think that there are a lot of people with narcotics problems, and they find different ways to get the fix, whether it is for themselves or maybe they're selling them. I don't know. But I remember when Matthew Perry's book, now the late Matthew Perry's book, came out. What was that called? The Big Bad Terrible Thing or something like that. He talked about when he was in the throes of narcotics addiction, he would go to open houses and raid the medicine cabinets of people's homes for drugs so that he could get his fix, hoping that none of them would ever suspect that Chandler Bing was stealing from them, right? There are a lot of reasons why people would do that, and from all walks of life. I don't know if it's true that she did that, but somebody alleged that she did. Okay, McRamble on, the son was a hauler, right? Yeah, John Cranston did haul Amish, according to their testimony. The neighbor knew him. IIRC, man, I'm too old to understand abbreviations. Sorry. Perhaps he met an Amish girl, got her pregnant, so another family adopted the kid. Perhaps this guy and his son weren't approved to care for the baby. Yeah, that goes into that whole rumor that I'm not quite sure is plausible yet. It's possible. Let's see. Yeah, sounds like the nurse was sneaking oxys. Yep. To take or to sell. Keegan asked, what year was that complaint? It is redacted, I think, Keegan. Let me look. Yeah, it's redacted. So I don't know. But let's see. I understand that Jamie and Sean, these are like second marriages, or at least it's a second marriage for Jamie. So it would have been after their marriage. I don't know off the top of my head when that was. Okay, guys, that's what I got for you today. Thank you for joining me on this Sunday afternoon. I appreciate you taking the time. This is a case that I will be keeping a very, very close watch on. Oh, Lily Wayne just came in with I wonder if the pills were going to her husband. Yeah, that's something I didn't. Thank you for bringing that up. Remember in the PCA where the Amish woman was saying he wasn't making sense when he was talking? That was one of those times that I was like, okay, was he high? Is it possible that he was high? Is it possible that he was getting oxy from his nurse wife who was taking it from the hospital where she was working? That is what I was wondering. So anyway, okay. Got so many false endings here. I just need to sign off. Thank you very much for joining me today. I'll keep on the case, and when I have new stuff, I will bring it to you. Thanks so much. We'll see you the next time.
Thank you very much for watching this video. If you liked what you saw, please consider subscribing. And if you have any questions or comments, please leave them below.